In this presentation, I'm going to share a little bit more about some of my research areas, specific projects that's going on in my group. And since I think I'm the first one to talk about human factors today, so I'll give also an introduction on human factors. So as a quick introduction, I'm Denny. I'm assistant professor here at Industrial Engineering. I also work a lot with the Indiana University School of Medicine, so I also do a lot of work in surgery. Very, very brief background. I did a lot of work in manufacturing. Most of my research has been focused on surgery, centered around some collaborations for industry, looking into medical devices, different types of exposure assessments, worked with insurance, and also did a postdoc at a hospital. So really quickly, what is human factors? Well, human factors, defined by the International Ergonomics, is the scientific discipline concerned with the understanding of interactions among humans and other elements of the system. So that's kind of the major, when you hear human factors, formal definition would be the bolded text right there. In addition, it's the profession that applies theory, principles, data, methods to design in order to optimize human well-being and overall system performance. To kind of put that in more of a, to illustrate that a little bit better, I have this quick picture here. Is that the comic here, it's a little bit fuzzy, but basically the caption says that management doesn't want us to call it coffee. They prefer it to be called ergonomic water. And that ties back to the underlying text, where it's optimizing the human well-being. And this artist here found a way to translate that into an office environment. Okay. So ergonomics, human factors, typically used interchangeably. So why study ergonomics? Here's some kind of very quick, feel free to grab a seat. Here's some very quick examples of why study ergonomics. Well, that's because bad design happens. These are a little bit silly. Hopefully none of you guys have encountered these issues. But in the first picture, you can see the distance where the toilet paper holder is from the from the actual toilet. And if you are, studied a little bit about work design, anthropometry, I mean, even without studying, you know the limitations of the human arm length. And there's also other ones that have similar issues. But more kind of problems that you may see every day. I mean, everybody in this room have probably ran into this problem, where you see a door, you think it's pushing, no, it's pull. Joke's on you. So why does those errors happen? Why is it frustrating? No, those are bad designs and design principles. These are silly examples, but they definitely make an impact on safety and kind of workers' health. So here's some other examples that are a little bit more serious. They're a little bit more on the silly side, but they do impact health. Even though we could design the best products ever, we, even with the good designs, unexpected things may happen. People may use your products, designs in unintentional ways, and may get injured themselves. So lesson here is that, well, although you could really, you could design, implement a lot of human factors principles, there's always some situations that you cannot completely eliminate error or unsafe use. So that's why we continue looking in this area as applying our principles to be able to design better products, better safety. So specifically, those are kind of general overview of human factors. I typically do that in a lot of my courses to do a very brief high-level overview of what human factors is, and it's kind of where you see it in everyday life. Well, more seriously, is I focus human factors in healthcare. And why do we focus human, or why is there a need to look at human factors in healthcare? So the Institute of Medicine published this groundbreaking report about, it's almost 15 plus years ago, called Tears to Human. And the reason why it caught so many attention and had so many people start looking at this error, human factors, is that this report found that that they estimated that around 98,000 deaths each year in the United States are due to medical errors. And you put that in context of kind of leading causes of death. It's the eighth leading cause of death, and it's in the top 10 list of healthcare-related cause of death. Now, 98,000, it's just a number. It's hard to visualize. Well, imagine 98,000 annually, that's about kind of the same frequency as a large plane going down every day. So we don't hear, you know, we don't get that type of, let me finish the animation. So that is kind of the impact of medical errors and what's happening in the healthcare space. It doesn't get a lot of attention because it's not as explosive as a plane going down, but 98,000 a year, if you do the calculation, plane's about 300, that's about really a plane going down every day. Now, I mentioned human factors is that, well, these medical errors aren't really errors in medicine or kind of user errors. These are kind of errors in design, engineering, systems. And that is what you're going to be hearing a lot about during your graduate studies here at IE, is the impact of the systems, how it impacts individuals, outcomes, and processes. So that's why we're studying, so that's why we're studying human factors here. And give you a couple examples. One big thing that they look at in terms of design standpoint, that you see a lot of errors from nursing, is bad connections. Here's a quick example of, so there's two different lines here, I believe. There's IV tubing and there's a tracheal tube or air tube. And the problem here is that the connections, well, these tubes, although they transport very different things, they can fit in the different the different connectors for the air tube, airway, or the IV. If you misconnect it, that leads to serious patient harm. In this case, let's see. Oh, this case study is about a child. Unfortunately, due to this mishap and misconnecting the tubes, this child actually sadly passed away. So here's another study that showed that more in kind of the medical device design, training is a big thing. You think about, we could just train everybody and they'll do well. So in this case, this is another case study about another infant that had an ear infection. And the promise, the prescription or the solution by the physician was to give the baby some type of antibiotics. And they use these, they insert these antibiotics using this syringe here. And during the doctor visit, the doctors taught the father how to deliver the medicine via syringe. So at home, let me get my laser pointer so you can follow along. Oops, that's not it. So at home, when the father tried to implement the dose, something happened. I blocked out the blue because that gives away the answer. I want you guys to think about this problem. He gave this dose to the child, and the child suddenly had difficulty breathing and collapsed. EMS services arrived. They tried to intubate the child, which putting a breathing tube, basically. It was not successful. By the time they got got to the solution, the result was that the lack of air had led to significant brain death. They removed the baby from life support, and the baby had to died shortly after. So any guesses on what happened here? Yeah. Aspirated.
Like breathed it in and swallowing.
Close, but this is, it kind of, they had trouble putting a breathing tube in. So that's kind of something that kind of indicates a blockage, right? Close. So Maya is super close. What basically happens was that, so although they trained them on the process, the syringe actually has a cap on the tip, and during this, the father forgot to remove the syringe cap, and it got lodged. So these kind of couple things here is that first of all, can we as engineers design this kind of a failure point away to make sure that humans do not or the users do not have an opportunity to have this kind of catastrophic failure. The other thing is more kind of and a lot of people, I think a lot of people also look into how do you better train, provide resources. So if you can't engineer it out, what type of administration controls can you do to ensure these don't happen? Okay, I'm running short on time, and I'll give Susan more time to do her presentation. But the second reason why we look at human factors, so we talked about the patient, but also human factors is a huge industry. It's one of the largest industry here in the U.S., healthcare, nursing aides, physicians. And although it's not readily seen, surgeons are actually are under kind of huge amount of stress, not just cognitive stress, but also physical stress, so injuries. So basically, you probably hear a lot of reports of nurses getting hurt on work, while also surgeons and physicians are also experience a lot of pain in surgery. These are just select papers that are quite recently where kind of the, so traditionally in medicine, he needs the patient always comes first. But now they're realizing that, well, you know, as we take care of our patients, our workforce is also getting the, I guess, this title captured it all, patients benefit while the physicians are suffering. So that leads to my general overview of the kind of the type of work that my group focuses on. First, like I mentioned, aching surgeon, how can we design things where it's more, where it facilitates more ergonomic use? How do we measure how much exposure, how long can they be under this type of level of stress before they start getting fatigued and injured? So that's the first part, aching surgeon. Second part, room for better balance. That one's more focused on how do we measure the team. A lot of surgical care or healthcare is operated or performed in teams. And when you have teams, you have ability to leverage different tasks, task assignments, disruptions, how do people handle disruptions. That's kind of the focus on this part is how do we measure the team performance, team interaction, and better design and facilitate processes and processes for patient care, during patient care. The big one that we're working on here is predicting cognitive load. I'll show a slide very quickly after this slide, showing that there's a relationship between cognitive load and human error. So as your cognitive load exceeds a certain capacity, then you start making errors. In this case, you know, we focus a lot on medical errors or human error. How do we do it? Well, since we're in engineering, we focus more on the sensing side. You can see this framework here. We take a lot of sensors like EEG, skin conductance, EMG sensors. And using a lot of machine learning data fusion techniques, can we associate that with cognitive load or high cognitive load? Finally, the last piece is, there's a lot of things that we do not know in healthcare. What is the level, threshold, dose response relationships for injuries and errors? But we do need an intervention right now. So we focus on developing or assessing usabilities of different tools that are currently used in the hospital. Tools, these are laparoscopic tools for surgery. How do you design the workstations so physicians don't have to assume interesting postures? Finally, I mentioned this quick slide here on cognitive load. As you can see here, when you measure cognitive load, there's certain red lines or threshold that puts you more at risk for errors. And if we looked at the surgical team, here, anesthesiologists, circulating nurse, a registered nurse, surgical assistants, residents, surgeons, you can see there's a distribution of workload. And in fact, a lot of the workload that we measured is actually exceeding this kind of threshold for increased risk for errors. So definitely a very hot topic of how do you accurately measure that in real time, develop wearables, interventions, and mechanisms to address it.